everyone, it's Silvia from Filatel. Welcome to my channel. Today we're going to have a look at a very exciting unboxing. I am so very happy that I received this today. It's about a couple of decks. So one of them is actually a present to a person that is very important in my life. So unfortunately, I won't be able to do the unboxing of that deck, because if this person watches the video, that is not going to be a surprise for her anymore. But there's another deck that I'm definitely going to show you. Now, this is coming from New Zealand, from Crystal at Munameya. Now, Munameya is the official reseller for Australia, New Zealand and the Oceania area of Arthur Wang's decks. So just for you to know, there's so many fake decks, especially the true black. I think that you can find a fake for like $5 now. And I'm not even gonna say the websites, because we all know which website that is. And it's appalling that they don't do anything to prevent these things from happening. I honestly, anyway, I have to stop myself from saying anything else, because it really drives me insane. What I'm extremely happy about is that, as always, the package, the parcel arrived really quickly from New Zealand. And Crystal has been absolutely lovely, so I highly recommend shopping with her. She will do everything in her power for you to have an amazing experience from the moment in which you get in touch with her. And I highly recommend getting in touch with her, not just, you know, buying whatever it is that you're buying out of her website, which is, as always, will be in the description box below. She's actually a really nice person, so I highly recommend getting in touch with her through her website. Or, you know, she has a really active, very nice Instagram account. So I'll put that one down as well. So get in touch with her, talk about the decks. She'll make sure that you'll be happy. I can guarantee you that 100%. So she is based in New Zealand. As I said, she's the official reseller of these decks. And I'm not gonna say any more about the fact that please be careful, there are so many fakes around. Please be careful. If the deck, if the true black especially, you see it for like $15, $20, $30, but even $50, because a friend of mine was like, oh, but I got it, I'm pretty sure it's the real one, it was $50. I'm like, no. Just no. Does it come in a tax box? That's your clue. It's not a real one. And I'm so sorry that this person wasted $50 Australian on that deck, because it was a fake one. But let's have a look. Okay, so I removed the main paper, because I never want to waste this paper. It's really nice. Sometimes I actually reuse it. Actually, most of the time I reuse it. And this is the card, the postcard. I'm not gonna flip it, because there's a very nice message just for me from Crystal. But this is part of the care with which she actually, you know, prepares the packaging. I can assure you it's a very interesting experience. And she's also mentioned that there's a couple of gifts for me. So I'm just gonna go ahead and film it. If they're very personal gifts, then I would just edit that part out, also, you know, out of consideration for Crystal. If it's not something personal, I'm happy to share it, because I really want you to see what you actually get when you order from her. Now, as I mentioned, there's two decks in here, so these are the two decks. And one of them, and I think it's this one, I really hope it's this one, is the present for this friend of mine. So I'm not going to open this one. I'm actually gonna, you know, leave it like that for her. So we're just going to remove that one. And fingers crossed, this is indeed the box that I got, the deck that I got from myself. I'm really keeping my fingers crossed, but I think that it might, yes, it is. Oh no, it's still wrapped. Sorry, I saw the color. I was like, yeah, that's the one, but it's still a wrap. So I'm getting really excited now. Let's have a look. This is a really nice ribbon that I can also reuse. So I'm all for the reusing. It's just recycling, reusing, buying new these days. I don't know about you guys, but with the inflation in Australia, everything is super expensive. I'm not going to talk about fuel prices going up because I know that it's a pain for each and every one of us in the whole world. And yes, indeed, that's the one that is indeed for me. So this is the True Black Tarot, as I said, by Arthur Wang. This is one of the most anticipated deck that I order around the Christmas time. Now, I knew that it wasn't gonna come here for Christmas, and I was absolutely okay with that because I also put the order in really late because I was waiting for a payment for my work to come through. But I'm so very happy about this one, and what we're going to do today is actually a really interesting work that I've been, you know, planning for a couple of weeks on the shadow part of our practice and the light part of our practice. So hopefully it's a very interesting kind of work and exercise that you can all, you know, try for yourself. But so let's have a look, because I'm so very curious about these ones now. I don't know, because the wrap is, so there's a black wrap for this one. And I don't know whether this is related to the other deck as well, or it's just, you know, just different color wrappings. So as you can see, there's just no possibility whatsoever that the decks will be damaged in transport, because Crystal is really taking so much care, you know, about the way in which she prepares the decks to be shipped out. Okay, so obviously we've got, well, this is, I'm just gonna put it here for you to be able to have a look. You know, there's the website, the address, and also the Instagram and the email. So if you want, you know, get in touch with her, and there's a description of what this is. I'm just very aware of private messages. I'm so very careful about not revealing any kind of personal details, because privacy is something that I personally value incredibly. And, you know, I want to lead by example. If I want you know, to live in a very safe environment, I have to provide a very safe environment. So readings, I give readings to my members. Up until the end of January, I also give a free complimentary reading of the Wheel of the Year to my members from the Sunlight tier up, so Sunlight and Starlight. So all of my members from those two tiers have received, or are in, you know, in the process of receiving, a free Wheel of the Year reading. But also every other Saturday I do free readings for my members. So if you want, check out my memberships, because it is a growing family, and it's becoming lots and lots of fun also to see how the interactions go, and you know, and also to feel like I'm actually doing something very tangible for the tarot community. So we've got a couple of cards pulled, Two of Wands and the Triumph, amazing, from Valeda Oracle. So the Two of Wands from This My Heart and the Triumph from the Valeda Oracle, a friendship bracelet made by me. So Crystal is actually very crafty as well, with an amethyst bead. So let's just have a look. So this is the Valeda Oracle. I have the Valeda Oracle and I really, really like it, by the way. And the Triumph card is fantastic. I am so very excited that these were not chosen, they were pulled. So this is what really came up. And the Two of Wands, this is me. I mean, if you know me, if you have been following my channel for the past 12 months, because I started 12 months ago, you will know that I'm always looking at a map, whether it's a spiritual map or an actual geographical map. For me, it's all about, you know, assessing where I am, understanding where I'm going. Am I happy with my decision and planning? That's my life. That's, you know, and it's been like that for decades. So it's actually very difficult to change. So we are going to have a look at the rest of the gifts here. So, okay, so there's the friendship bracelet with the amethyst. That is really cool. I get a few of these from Crystal during the years, and they're very durable, I have to say. They're not just nice, but they're actually really good quality. And it's got the amethyst bead. So we got a couple of crystals, Euclid quartz, green aventurine, sodalite, and changite wee tumbles. I hope I'm pronouncing the names. I just know the names in Italian sometimes of crystals, but I don't necessarily know how to pronounce them correctly in English. I love this, the opalite moon. Oh my goodness, look at that. It's so beautiful. So opals are obviously a very important part of the Australian, let's say, mineralogy, because they are indeed from Australia. But this is opalite, and I think it's got some kind of different morphology to it. Now, please forgive me because I'm not an expert. I really don't know what I'm actually saying. I love crystals. I love using them. But I know only two or three of them because I decided that it was very important for me to actually know how to use them before, just going out and buying 15 or 20 of them. Of course, I would love to do that. This is so beautiful. I don't know. I think it's the bronzite flagstone, could be. And then we've got a smaller one here. That's very cute. So these are all the crystals, and we've got a jar which is very interesting. So the little jar of magic, tiger's eye, smoky quartz point, strawberry quartz, action, protection, and affection. Oh, that's so lovely. Action, definitely. Oh my goodness, of course, with the two of wands. Protection, yes, please. And affection, that's amazing. Thank you so much, Crystal. It's just an amazing present. And I love jars. I really love tiny jars like this. They're part of my. I have a few. I'm just gonna show you quickly because there's another friend of mine in the tarot community that makes them, and she still hasn't set up a shop, like an Etsy shop or something like that. But these are super cute, aren't they? And I really, really appreciate when I get something like this because it's always about the intention and it's actually really cute. Now, I really think that these are related to the other deck because there was a clear distinction in the color of the wrapping paper. So I'm just gonna reach out to, before I open it, I'm just gonna reach out to Crystal and ask her whether this one is related to the other deck, because if it is, then I'm definitely going to, give it together with the deck as a present to my friend. So I'm not gonna open it right now, but I am so excited about all these things. It's like receiving like seven or eight presents, little gifts that are always so much appreciated because of the care that is put into them. And I'm so very happy about these bracelets because, as I said, really high quality, very durable. I don't know if you're familiar with this concept, but basically, and I don't know whether it's something that it's just common, let's say, to my culture, so the Italian culture. In this case, you put these bracelets, you tie them up very tight on your wrist, obviously, and you never take them out. And you make a wish, and once you obviously shower with them, you live your life, you sleep with them, you don't take them out. So technically, when they break, the wish comes true. But again, I'm not entirely sure that it's actually a common knowledge. It might be some kind of tradition that we just have in Italy. But we used to do this all the time. And back in my days, I actually used to make this as well. Believe it or not, I used to do these kind of crafty things. I don't know what happened. I lost everything. Now I couldn't. I really couldn't. But I'm sure that, that's also the way it's meant to be. I'm really grateful about receiving them as gift. But let's have a look at this deck because, oh my God. So I know that I come very late to the party. I get it. But this deck is just so beautiful. I hesitated for quite some time to get it because to be honest with you, I saw everyone got the fake copy and that made me really mad. And I was thinking it's so unfair for the creator. No matter what your job is, you must know how important it is for everyone to get their fair share, of what they do, and to be able to, when they sell something, to actually make a profit on it. Because we all need to survive, don't we? I mean, we don't live off hope and love and air. Of course, we do need that, but unfortunately, living costs money. And I think it's unfair when you create something and you put it out there, and it's really like putting out there a piece of your soul, and someone else just goes and steals your creation and sells it for like $5. I mean, that's horrible. Seriously, it's horrible. But it's also horrible to, I mean, obviously, if you make a mistake, oh my goodness, it happened to me a couple of times. I made a mistake. It wasn't on an expensive deck, to be honest with you. It was an indie deck, but and I also paid the price that it would have sold, the real deck, the original deck would have sold at. But when I got it, I just, it did not look like a fake at all. And the only thing that was different from that copy and the fake, from the original copy and the fake copy, was that there was a thumbprint cutout on the 2-bar box. And I reached out to the creator and said, "Is this really a fake? Because I paid this much and everything else looks exactly the same as the original." And she confirmed to me, yeah, that's what they're doing now. They make them practically 99.99% the same. In this case, the true black dough, when it's a fake copy, you see it immediately. So this is the booklet. Now, I got this deck because I recently got the Ephemer Tarot, and that really gave me an idea on how to work with shadow work by using the true black and light work by using the Ephemer Tarot with an oracle deck, which is so very special, that actually is the deck that gives you the possibility to work in shadow and light with these two decks. But first, let me just go ahead and show you this beauty because it's an amazing deck. And I also want to feel, how the cards feel like, because I know that it might be slightly different from the Ephemer. Of course, it's got this really cool, glossy kind of black foil, on the cards themselves. These are the backs. So of course I'm expecting most of you will be familiar with this deck because it's by no means a new deck. But it is new in my collection, and I really wanted to do this unboxing with you because I value you as my subscribers. So, and I wanted to share the joy because it's always, getting a deck, even though I paid for it, but it's almost as if it was a present. And so the experience of receiving a deck is the equivalent of, receiving a present. Now, I feel like there's a few cards that actually stick together because of the, probably because of the edging. Sometimes that's the very first time in which you open a deck, if this kind of edging has been migrating, that's the technical term, ink has been migrating into the cards, and maybe some cards actually stick together. What I'm gonna do, I'm just gonna go ahead and detach them all, not to do that, on camera, and then we're going to get back to the cards and have a look. Okay, we're back. So this is an amazing deck because I had a little peek at the cards. These are still the majors, absolutely incredible. Some of them have been renamed. As you see, for example, the Wheel of Fortune has been renamed to Destiny. Now, the name is in that glossy kind of black foil, so it's not always visible in camera. I can assure you 100% that it is entirely visible when you actually use the cards. This is just a matter of refraction of that, let's say, glossy foil. I don't know if you can tell, but the death cab, for example, has got are these kanjis or not. This is Chinese writing. And I am so excited about working with both of these decks together. So the True Black and the Ephemer. The Ephemer has got even more writings on the cards with different languages and alphabets. But this one looks as well like there is some kind of dash and dot. Not like the Morph alphabet. I don't know if you can tell. But it's so very exciting for me. Looks like this one also has got some writing here, but unfortunately I'm not wearing my reading glasses and I can't really tell. I just love the way in which, you know, these symbols are integrated into the card. So it's obviously something very unique that you can see. I do not know of any other deck that is so, let's say, almost otherworldly beautiful, in the otherworldly in the sense that, yes, we do have human beings here. However, they look so perfect, and not perfect in the lack of diversity. I think I've managed to say this or to explain this when I was looking at the Ephemer Tarot. The human beings that are depicted in the cards are actually perfect because they're not representing actual persons, actual people. They're representing archetypes. They're representing energies and vibes and forces, let's say. They are, if you will, representing humanity. So I'm not actually bothered by the fact that there is virtually no diversity whatsoever, because I do believe that they're not representing that particular person, but as I said, just the idea of humanity. And as a matter of fact, their skin is not Caucasian, it's actually white, as in gray, almost gray, let's say. So it's not to be ascribed to one ethnic group or another. Of course, I could be wrong. This is the way I feel like when I'm actually working with the Ephemer Tarot, and I'm pretty much convinced that this is also the way that I will feel when working with the True Black. But of course, this is, you know, it's, I don't remember reading anything like it anywhere in the guidebook, so I could be completely wrong. This is the additional card. It's called Anand. I don't know if you can see that. So it's the unborn, basically. The symbol, you know, it's an Ouroboros with the snake, but it's not the traditional way in which the snake in the Ouroboros is depicted, because the snake is not biting its own tail. However, it is coiled to form this circle of life within which we can actually see an unborn child. And to me, the symbology of that is incredibly interesting, because it reminds me of the Enzo. The Enzo in Japanese is this circle that is not perfect, because it is representing life. So life is not perfect. If it were a perfect circle, it would not be life. It would not be representing life. And I can tell you, I've been exercising in my calligraphy. I've been trying, I think I tried something like, I don't know, 2000. So they tell you that you really have to exercise by repeating the circle over and over and over and over again until you can do it with your eyes closed. The problem is that I couldn't really find consistency when I was studying calligraphy, and I got very impatient, which is the one thing that you really need to avoid. And so I did not continue doing that. And then one day I just picked it up because I had new, new inks in, and I really wanted to do something nice. And I tried an Enzo without, you know, my goal that day was to try and see the ink color. So I wasn't trying to do a perfect Enzo, and of course I got a perfect Enzo. But anyway, so this is very beautiful. I think it really brings in traditions from the East and the West together, which is always very, very much welcome. So, as I said, I am going to today we're going to have a look at this bit of let's say working with shadow and light using this deck and the other deck by the same author, so the FME Tarot. Let me just grab it. Okay, so this is the tarot I was talking about, the FME Tarot. As you can see, it's got a very similar production value to the True Black. Obviously, it's in white, and the foil is actually in gold. I don't know if you can see it. Let me just play with it under the light so that you can see the reflection. It is a lovely deck, such a lovely deck. You've seen it in my channel several times. Why? Because I cannot stop talking about this deck. It's an absolute beauty. I really enjoy working with it as well. I also want to point out that it does have a renaming of pretty much, I think, all of the majors. But it's a really well thought kind of renaming. Sometimes, especially when it comes to renaming the core cards, I've seen stuff that just did not work. I don't know what the creators were doing. There is one tarot deck in particular that I really loved the images, but they renamed the core cards in different ways between suits. So I don't know, one, for example, a page would have been named Princess, which is perfectly fine, but then in another suit, the same deck but a different suit, would have been still named Page. And then I don't know, the queen was named Dame, but then in a different suit was still named Queen. So I thought to myself, either you stick to the same renaming for all of the core cards of all of the suits in the same deck, or you don't change the names. I mean, it needs to be consistent. This is one of the things that really present like a deal breaker for me. But what I wanted to show you is that I'm going to actually pair these two up with the Soul Mirror Oracle. This is a fantastic oracle deck by Sunshine Connolly. The artwork is by Anna Noves. And this is a Blue Angel release. And it's a relatively recent deck, or let's say since probably, I don't know, September, something like that. At least this is when it has been released in Australia, because Blue Angel is Australian, and contrary to Rockpool, they actually do release decks first in Australia and then in the rest of the world. But it's been a couple of months, so I'm pretty sure this is available. In any case, I will always put the link to purchase this deck if you want to in the description box below. Now, the reason why I really believe that this combination works really well for this type of work. So, we're going to focus on the FME Tarot when it comes to light work. We're going to focus on the True Black when it comes to shadow work, and the conduit or the focus of this work, and also the card that is going to enable this kind of work is the Soul Mirror Oracle, because the Soul Mirror Oracle is very, very special. I'm just going to show you here. As you can see, apart from the beauty of the images and the fact that the keywords resonate so much, it also has two. So this is the title, let's say, of this card. This is relationships. And at the bottom, I don't know if you can see. Let me just do that. So you've got two keywords, distant and connected. So as you can imagine, distant is referring to shadow work and connected is referring to light work. So what we're going to do, it's going to be a very special pairing that I've actually never tried before, because obviously just today I received a True Black, so I couldn't really do this before. And I just imagined, I just thought, I just had a hunch that this would have been working. So you are my guinea pigs, because I'm definitely trying this out with you first. So let's have a bit of a shuffle of all three decks. Okay, so now that we shuffled all three decks, these are the backs, by the way. I don't know whether I've been showing the backs from the FME Tarot. This is also really beautiful gold foil. Absolutely amazing. I cannot stop talking about this deck, how beautiful this deck is. Now, we're going to use the Oracle. So for now, we're just going to set aside the two tarot decks. And we're just going to pull. So it's already shuffled, but in order to get into the mood, I'm just gonna shuffle again. So we're just gonna pull a card out of the Oracle deck, And then we're just going to focus on the title and the two keywords of the card. So here we go. Okay. Let's just put this card awareness. So I'm just gonna put it here just so that it's still within the frame. Now what we're going to do with this card is we're going to focus on the image of the card, we're going to look at the title, awareness, and we're going to also focus on the two keywords, one corresponding to the shadow work and one corresponding to the light work. And then what we're going to do, we're definitely going to pull three cards for the shadow work and three cards for the light work. And then it's always up to you in the sense that I normally do a lot of meditation, I do a lot of journal writing, I do sometimes also taking photos, or I just remind myself of what the reading looked like, and then I may print them or not. It depends on how much ink I got left in my printer. But this is what I wanted to show you. So basically, we're going to work with this card. So this is the card of awareness. The keywords are foolish and conscious, and that's absolutely striking a chord within me, because awareness is not something that you can take for granted. Awareness is something that needs to be very grounded, I believe. So you cannot just let's say shoot for awareness in your life and then as soon as you believe you've reached it, then your work is done, because it's not how it goes, it's not how it works. You can actually be, in a way, you can actually be still aware but be a fool, in the sense that your behavior towards what you learn thanks to your awareness is the way in which you will be remembered, in which you will be measured, in which your actions will be measured against, let's say, society, against yourself, against the person in your relationship or the persons in your relationship, and not necessarily just a romantic relationship, but any kind of relationship. So are you a fool in this awareness, or are you conscious? It's are all your choices, once you've reached awareness, depending on that grounding or not? Do you still make foolish choices, or are you always making a conscious choice for yourself, for others, for society, for the world? So that's a very interesting concept. I like the card of awareness. It's a card that really gives you the opportunity to work a lot on yourself. What I'm going to do just for this first card, I'm not going to do it for all of the cards that I'm going to pull, but I'm just going to quickly read what the guidebook is saying about that particular card. So awareness is, so the beautiful thing is that they're all in alphabetical order, so it's very easy to find them even though there are no numbers. So awareness, bring your awareness to your inner being by sitting quietly and listening in the quietude of your mind. Let yourself be guided to the pure and unadulterated voice of your inner conscience. Meditating is a discipline that trains your mind to quiet the constant noise and distractions of the outside world, enabling you to access the unchanging truth of your being. And then it tells you what to do, basically. It gives you a bit of a homework in order to be able to meditate and indeed, you know, achieve the right, let's say, level of awareness. And it's just what I really love about this guidebook is also that the fact that we have at the end of the description of each card, we also have a little bit of, perhaps one paragraph, you know, in which we have a lot of journal prompts. So reflection, how can I become more conscious of patterns and situations in my life and gain a deeper understanding of what may be triggering me out of my center of peace? That's fantastic. Being aware of your surrounding in order for them not to trigger you is so powerful that, to be honest, I would stay for months with a card like that, but then that's just me. What steps can I take to face and confront any areas that I may be ignoring or avoiding, and actively seek out opportunities for growth and self-awareness? And that's another really big one. It's a bomb, isn't it? So obviously we are all trying to avoid getting confronted with things that we, that may be a trigger, may represent a trigger for us or may not, but in any case they're still hurting us. And because we are always driven by a sense of self-preservation, of course we're trying to step away from what really confronts us, what hurts us. And there are times in which that is absolutely necessary, that is the right thing to do, but there are other times in which we cannot just keep on running away, and we need to face certain things. So now let's have a look at what I wanted to do. So we take the true black, because as I was mentioning earlier, I believe that the true black is very conducive, or could be very conducive for a deeper understanding of the shadow meaning of the card. So the shadow meaning of the card awareness is foolish. So as I said, it's been shuffled already, but just to shuffle it again. Okay, so normally I would just fan out the cards, but I don't have much room, so I'm just gonna do like this and pick a card. So we're going to put to pick one card that represents the situation in which my awareness has not developed or progressed into a conscious awareness, but in which I still see myself doing making foolish choices. That would be one center card. Wow, gee, okay. Talk about, you know, sample reading. There is no such a thing as a sample reading, especially when I channel so much about myself when I pick a card. Okay, I got you. I mean, it's probably my fault because I keep on referring to this deck as a shadow work deck, and of course the Six of Swords come to, it comes to the surface, and absolutely, so I'm still very foolish when I do these kind of transformative adventures in my life. I've been, embarking upon these kind of journeys most of the times because I was forced to, other times because I forced myself to do that. But it's still, I still don't know where I'm going. I think that I'm not particularly foolish in the sense that I know. So foolish does have two kind of meanings. One is knowing that you're jumping into the void and you do still take a leap of faith because you believe in something stronger. So we're looking at the fool in the traditional meaning of the tarot. But in other cases, foolish just means that you know what you're getting yourself into, especially when it comes to a Six of Swords. And, you know, whether you're forced to do that or you force yourself to do that, you just do it anyway in a foolish way because you just know how much is going to hurt and how difficult it's going to be. So this is going to be the center card. And so what I normally do, I will pick another two cards. And this will tell me the first card that I pick in this position. Okay, this is telling me what the situations were that brought this card into existence or into being, let's say. And this is the Hermit card. So the Hermit card tells me that these are events in the past, or this is probably still something that is still recurring in my present. So the need that I have to know myself, to get grounded, and also to kind of develop any kind of focus that I may have lost in the last 2, 3, 4 years. This is what brought me to this change, to embarking upon this really difficult and painful journey towards something better. Because obviously, once you get to know your true self, then obviously there's a lot of things that are going to get better in your life. And then I'm going to pull another card, and this is going to tell me what the outcome of this work or journey is going to be. Destiny, of course, that's the Wheel of Fortune, as I was mentioning earlier. Let me just pull this one this way, because otherwise you can't see. So, of course, this is obviously, we're talking about ups and downs. I love the fact that we have two alchemical symbols, you know, for fire and water, because it does indeed give you the possibility to feel the alchemical properties of these two. So the fact that both fire and water are dynamic elements, However, fire cannot be contained, water can. Fire, because it cannot be contained, also refers back to the impulsive traits of a person. We have a fiery personality. We refer back to the Suit of Wands, for example. And if you're part of my members, if you're a Sunlight or Starlight member, you will know now how to recognize and work with archetypes, because that's a work, that's something that we're doing as a study. And also the water is, on the contrary, can be contained, because you can put water in a container. Of course, it needs to be a container large enough to contain the water, but the shape of the container doesn't really constrain water, because water is very adaptable, very versatile. It can literally take the shape of the place where it is. So if this is the outcome, I'm definitely liking it. Because it teaches me that I will be able, if I process my awareness from foolishness into consciousness, I will be aware of my surroundings, and I will take the shape of my surroundings. So I will still have the power of fire, because also it's a creative power, but it's also a destroying power, so it needs to be controlled with the power of water, which is definitely controllable and definitely can take the shape of the environment. Now, this is my shadow work with the card of awareness, I'd say. And now let's have a look. Let me just put this here because I think that it's just easier. You can still see this two word, just to make it so that I can fit the other three cards from the Ephemera Tarot. So now I'm going to pull three cards the same way as I've done here. So one card in the middle and then the left and then the right. And I'm going to focus instead on the light meaning of this word, of the keyword awareness. So as always, I'm just gonna shuffle again to set the mood. Okay. While I'm shuffling, I'm noticing that the Ephemera is slightly, let's say, less easy. Let's put it this way. It's not difficult to shuffle, but it's slightly less easy than the True Black. So as I'm done with the True Black now, I'm just going to focus on the first card, because the first card is going to tell me what the situation is in which I'm actually exercising a conscious level of awareness. And it's the Four of Swords, and it's absolutely spot on, 100%. Let me just see if I can put it here to be very symmetrical, or as much as possible. So the Four of Swords is, to me, it's a card I had to reckon with. It's a card I had to reckon with, but I've done that. I have accepted that. I've done a lot of work on, let's say, accepting when to step back, accepting when to take a break, accepting when to nourish myself, knowing what I nourish myself with, whether it's something like food or friendships, people around me, you know, stuff I watch on TV, at the movies, music I listen to, books that I read, etc. You know what I mean. I've been talking about this, I think, recently, also for my Starlight members in our healing step-by-step videos. So this is very important, because it's also what I notice is also that I got two cards from the Suit of Swords for the present situation, which is, it makes sense, because obviously, you know, we look at the situation in which we're moving away from something that did not serve us, and it's a difficult journey we're embarking upon, and most of the time we don't necessarily know where we're going. As a matter of fact, in many traditional depiction of the symbols of the Six of Swords, the person that is doing this crossing the river, which has really choppy waters, by the way, is not looking into the direction of where the boat is going. It's actually looking backwards, which is something that distinguishes the Six of Swords from the Eight of Cups. In the Eight of Cups, you're looking away from the cups. That situation is definitely broken, and your departure is very much emotional. In this case, there is emotion, I can assure you, 100%, but it's the suit of the mind. So there's a lot of involvement in the thoughts, and your thoughts. Now, it makes sense that this card would be followed by a light card, a lighter, let's put it this way, card, which is the Four of Swords. The Four of Swords is definitely that kind of consolidation, the number four numerologically, referring to consolidation in the alchemical suit of air. So when we take a break, we ask the air around us to take a break with us. It is something that we need to go through in order to be able to then face everything else that is coming towards us, and it's very conscious. This rest that I'm taking is very conscious. It's a conscious choice, and it's a choice that is determined by the awareness or the light side of the awareness in this situation. Just to give you a very practical example, very true. Recently, I have found out that I have acute tendonitis, which is not fun at all. If you've had it, if you have it, if you know of it, if you know someone who has it, I mean, you're in my case, because I hate being sick, I really can't stand it because I need to do a million things. And I'm like, I don't want to be sick. I want to keep on doing stuff. Being temporarily crippled in the sense that it's really crippling. Okay, it's disabling me because the doctor was like, if you don't rest, I've had it for 3 months. The doctor was very upset because technically 3 months is when you start seeing improvements. Actually, you start seeing improvements after 2 months, but because it's me, everything is very slow. And the last visit was like, it's been over 3 months, and not only has he seen any improvement, or have I felt any improvement, but it's actually gotten much, much worse. And the reason is because I'm not resting. I'm not. And that's the only way. You can take medications, but I hate medications, so... he literally said, if you don't want to take anti-inflammatories, you have to rest as much as possible, literally just not be on your foot. But it's impossible for me. And so now that I've seen how painful it can become, how bad it can become, and how bad it has become, this is a very conscious choice. It actually comes from a foolish reaction to that. It is becoming a very conscious choice in which I'm actually resting and putting everything else aside for the time being, my walks, my getting fit and everything, because I just can't. I mean, if I don't get it seriously, if I don't consciously choose to rest, I'm never gonna get rid of it. Okay, so this is just one example of a conscious awareness of the Four of Swords. And now I was about to shuffle again, but I don't need to shuffle again. Let's pick another couple of cards to see what the situation was that brought about, the existence of the Four of Swords. And I'm guessing it's not related to my tendonitis. Okay, Dulces, that's actually is indeed... Okay, well, I just practically gave it away. Dulces is the renaming of the Devil card, and it's absolutely right. So this is my being a slave to my physical activities. I would literally, if I wasn't reaching my targets in my step, not now, but this is the situation that brought this into being. So I was so fixated with reaching my step target that if I was not reaching it by 10:50 p.m., I would literally just go for like 10 minutes up and down the stairs just to reach that target at midnight. And that had become a little bit of a addiction for me. It can be a good thing. Fitness is fantastic, okay? It is part of that nourishment we were talking about. Of course, you need to stay fit because your body necessitates a level of fitness in order to not break down, basically. However, when it becomes too much, and in my case it had become too much, I was literally dependent on that, on the adrenaline of knowing that I was reaching that goal, for example. And because I'm very competitive, on top of everything, I was in a group that was doing that and I was winning every single week. And I didn't realize that I was pushing people away because they were like, no, you need to let someone else win every now and then because you're becoming unpleasant. And I just didn't see it. So that was definitely a devil situation for me that brought this into being. So I now don't do that anymore. I just have to accept that I have to heal. But let's see what the outcome will be. Please be a good card. Okay, let's see. Sorry. It does stick together a little bit. Oh, Victor, fantastic. Thank you. Well, ask and it is given. Well, there you go. So, okay, Victor is obviously a fantastic card. It's the victory card, obviously. It's a card that refers to, you know, when you set your mind into doing something, no matter how hard it is, if you have the right skills, you know, you may see the light at the end of the tunnel. You may reach that light and you may bask into the light at a certain point of your journey. So obviously, this is telling me a very clear picture and it's a very beautiful reading. As a matter of fact, I think I'm going to implement this into my members' readings, you know, doing some light and shadow work for them because it's a very interesting, it gives you a lot of journaling prompts, for example, a lot of motivation for meditation as well. It looks into a situation from two different aspects, as I said, the shadow and the light kind of aspects of the same thing. And it's also very good because it's cohesive as a spread in the sense that you always refer back to the awareness keyword. So it's not, let's say, it's not dispersive, if that makes sense. So I'm really, really enjoying this. And I really invite you to try this. So do you have these decks? If you do, just for you to know, the Soul Mirror Oracle is a mass market deck published by Blue Angel, as I said before. It's very affordable, very affordable. The price of a pizza here in Australia, if I have to be honest. And the True Black and the Ephemere are indie decks. So of course they are more expensive, but they have the, you pay for the quality as well and the production value. As I said, Muna Maya Crystal is, so I know that I actually had a look at what Arthur names as, you know, resellers, official resellers in Australia and New Zealand. There's a couple of other shops that do sell these decks, but I'm not entirely sure. I had a quick look and one of them has ceased, let's say, trading, unfortunately, and another one only has the True Black but doesn't have the Ephemere. So Crystal has both. So if you are in Australia, New Zealand, I highly recommend getting in touch with her. I don't know how many copies she's got in stock. So that was it for today. It was a very interesting unboxing and, you know, first impression and working with the True Black, but together with the Soul Mirror, as I said, and the Ephemere, I think that we've got something really, potentially really interesting here. And I'm looking forward to hear what your experience is. If you have these decks, it'd be very nice for you to let me know in the comments below how you find them. Do you work in this in a similar way? But for now, have a great day.